From the garden to the shadows, every heartbeat belongs to you like a sharp arrow. Oh, you guide me, you send me through. Now I started so shallow, deeper. You pull me down when it's hardest to follow. I remember to hold up the crown.
How to handle your imminence, but bow beneath the extravagance, and still you're standing with those.
Sets me free, no. Oh, my love is here.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Damascus Road. As you can see from our clip, we are getting ready to have a dinner party. So our whole series for the next 4 weeks is about the idea of a dinner party and looking at the different feasts and banquets that Jesus attended and what that can tell us about our God and community. So we're super excited. We are glad that you are our guests this morning. And today we are setting the table. So in a little bit, Ryan will come up and he'll give a message about what does the table of Jesus look like, what is the invitation that we are having into God's great feast. Before that, we just have a couple announcements. Want to invite you guys to lunch after church today. Our community loves to eat. Food is our favorite, and so we want to feed you guys. So if you don't have lunch plans already, we all get hungry around noon, so stay, eat food, get to know some people. There'll be free pizza over in the cafe right after church, so I want to invite you guys to stay after. Then wanted to also let you guys know about our Kickstarter card. So in the back on the info table, there's these fancy green cards, and these are called Kickstarter cards, and we basically want to encourage you to try out our community. So there are 5 different levels, and so if you attend 5 different events, at the end, we will give you a cool, fancy steel water bottle so you can have sustainable hydration here in Tucson. But if you attend 3 events, you have a free retreat to Momentum, which is our fall retreat. It's all back there. It's self-explanatory. And just want to let you know about a couple events that you can attend this week that could go towards your Kickstarter. So we have a game night on Tuesday, which is at the Den in the Global Center. We have a movie night on Friday. We're going to watch Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, which is an excellent movie if you have not seen it. We have a big blow-up screen. We hang out in Highland Bowl together and watch movie, eat popcorn. We also have the food bank, which is a service opportunity that we do once a month. On Friday, we get together at Caring Ministries, which is a place that takes all the excess food from grocery stores in Tucson that's going to go to waste. And we help pack boxes there. And then on Saturday morning, we distribute it on campus to people who need food, who are hungry. The food is going to go to waste anyway, and we want people to get it instead of it being thrown in the trash. And so if you need food or if you want to help give away food, that's happening on Saturday. And any of those events would count towards your Kickstarter card. Those are our couple of announcements for this morning. And then offering is something that we do every week here at Damascus Road. We think it's a really great practice for our souls. And offering is a great way to practice God's mantra of abundance versus scarcity. And so in Matthew 6:31, Jesus tells us not to worry about things because God provides for all of our needs. He says, don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, but your heavenly Father already knows all of your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything that you need. So let me pray as we start our service, and I'll invite Ryan to come up. Lord, I thank you for what a good and amazing God you are. I thank you that you invite us into your party and into your feast, and we're just excited about what you're doing and getting to join you in that, Lord. I pray over Ryan as he speaks your word, that you will help us to have open hearts and open ears to what you want to say to us this morning, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everyone. Today is a great day. It's wonderful to see you here this morning and to celebrate the presence of God and the presence of his people. Today is also the day before classes start for UA, so that means today is the last chance to find that classroom, familiarize yourself with campus, enjoy life without homework, maybe even find a great church. The psalmist exhorts us, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. So we gather and we worship and we rejoice in this beautiful gift of life and another day in God's good world. No matter what circumstances we are facing or what anxieties we may have entered the day with, there is much to be thankful for if we have the eyes to see the blessings of God. And one of the blessings that I'm celebrating today is that today is my son Roland's 6th birthday. 6 years ago today, he was born and radically changed my life. I used to be young, almost still a newlywed, but now I'm a father of a kindergartner. The gray hairs have multiplied, the pounds mysteriously have added to my frame, and more children seem to appear out of nowhere. But most importantly, the love has multiplied. I'm thankful for the little boy who isn't so little anymore that has made me a father. Now, to celebrate Roland's birthday, we had a party yesterday. This wasn't any normal 6-year-old's party, as my brother Brad mentioned to me. There was no Paw Patrol. There was no Disney or Marvel. Not even great kids shows like Octonauts or Bluey or Hilda. None of this. No, this was a Star Realms-themed party. Now, if you're not familiar with Star Realms, it is a space-themed deck-building game designed to be played by teenagers or adults. But Roland loves it. He's memorized the cards since he can't read. He knows what they all do. He's happy to advise you on which cards you should purchase to crush your opponent next time you play. Roland spends a lot of time creating his own versions of Star Realms cards. So for his birthday, Megan designed 3 new factions. Dave printed them up so they look like real cards. And we created our own cards yesterday. All the guests were invited to join Roland's favorite activity in making epic spaceships and space stations to play in this game that he loves. Not only did we have awesome space card creation, Megan made Roland's favorite pasta for us all to share, as well as a fantastic lemon blueberry cake. And as someone who clearly appreciates food, it was quite the party. Now, Roland's party was not the only party that I've been to recently. My nephew Zane just celebrated his 14th birthday on Friday. Now, this party featured lots of prepubescent testosterone, many bros and bras said non-ironically, a sea of white Air Force Ones, and poorly applied Axe body spray. But really, what mattered is this was exactly what Zane wanted for his birthday. And we hung out, and we ate pizza, and he played volleyball with his friends, and we were happy to celebrate him, even if it wasn't quite as celebratory as maybe his mother Lacey would have preferred. Now, his mother Lacey also recently had a milestone birthday. I'll let you guess which milestone it was. And my brother hosted a dinner party for her. We ate great food. We enjoyed wonderful friends. We celebrated Lacey's presence in our lives. And we even oohed and aahed over her new bedroom set. Yes, we're old enough that there's excitement over a new bedroom set. This is your future. Get used to it now. Now, all of these recent parties were great in their own ways. But I've been to other parties that weren't necessarily all that great. They weren't gatherings of joy and celebration. In fact, they looked a little bit more like a Dwight Schrute party from The Office. That is both hilarious and depressing. If that was your birthday, that is not the sort of conference room you want to walk into at work. Thankfully, I have never been to a party quite as poorly decorated or poorly thought out as a Dwight Schrute party, but I've been to a few that were maybe a little close. And maybe, for some people, this is why they don't want to party with Christians. Once people know an event is going to be hosted by Christians, they automatically decide not to come, because a Christian party is a boring party. Now, I think most people outside of the church, and even many in it, think that the celebrations of the followers of Jesus are drab and boring affairs. Because some of the time, a Dwight party is what happens. And partially inflated brown balloons just are not particularly festive. This should not be so in the community of faith. And we do a disservice to our God, to ourselves, and to the gospel, because we have more to celebrate than anyone else. Now, this idea, this image, that the community of Jesus should be celebratory, should be more like a party, is one that Jesus uses again and again. He describes his kingdom using the idea of a party, or specifically a feast. A bit like a great dinner party but like the best of all dinner parties. And this is what we're going to explore here in our first series of the fall. Wouldn't it be better if people thought of a dinner party or a great celebration when they thought of the community of Jesus instead of boring, stiff, brown balloons sorts of people? What are the components of a great dinner party, and how does this show us what a church, and our church specifically, should be, and what we aspire and desire to become? So we'll explore hospitality, open dialogue, delicious food, a servant-hearted cleanup crew, through four lessons from Jesus in the Gospels about how the kingdom of God is a great feast. So no matter where we've been, we're all invited to the party, into the celebration and the presence of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, Jesus was no stranger to parties himself. In fact, Jesus' attendance at parties was a source of controversy during his ministry. This breach of table custom that happened again and again was so prevalent in Jesus' life that Jesus says he is accused of being a glutton and a drunkard. While some people today may view Christians as boring and enjoying Dwight Schrute-esque parties, Jesus was very different than that idea. This accusation of being a glutton and a drunkard is clearly disapproving, and the phrase actually is a legal charge in Jewish culture against Jesus and a direct quotation from Deuteronomy. In ancient Israel, when parents confronted a rebellious son, they took their son to court and they made this charge against him. This son of ours is stubborn and rebellious and he refuses to obey. He is a glutton and a drunkard. And if this charge in court was upheld, the rebellious son would be stoned to death, which is pretty terrible. Right? Now, this is the fate of the famous story of the prodigal son. This is the fate that the prodigal son faced returning home. After squandering his fortune frivolously, there was a very real possibility that when the son returned, he would have this charge brought against him. Not just humiliation and humbling before his father, but the possibility of being stoned to death by his community because his behavior was so outside, so beyond the pale for the people who were following God at the time. So why does the father in the story wait and watch? Why does he run when he sees his boy down the road? Because of his great love, for sure, absolutely. The incredible love of the father, but also to save his son from the community taking it upon themselves to punish this glutton and drunkard of a son that everyone knew he was. This is how radical Jesus was. He was using the dinner table, his celebrations and feasting to create a new community at the risk of his own life. At his table, the love of God and the love of others was modeled and celebrated, not in a boring way, but in an incredibly attractive way. And this is the sort of community that we should be, one that is full of joy. Many people, when they disparage God, especially God of the Old Testament, they talk about the anger or the wrath of God. But what they leave out is that these are just temporary emotions that are a response to the evil and the sin of the world. It is the appropriate response to a world that is not as it should be and to people who abuse and hurt each other. When Roland hurts Aiden, it is normal that I would want to I would be angry, want to protect my younger son from an older son, and they'd be a little angry. I'm not perpetually angry, but rather that is a response to injustice, right? In spite of the pain of the world, though, God is a God of joy, not of wrath. When the world is set to right, his anger and wrath will disappear to be replaced with eternal joy. God has an irrepressible joy, and he desires for his people to be joyful as well. And we see this early in Jesus' ministry. Before he became well known, Jesus was invited to a wedding feast in a nearby town that was in serious need of joy. This is John 3, if you want to follow along where we're headed. Jesus is there with a few of his early disciples, and his mother was in attendance as well. Not long into the celebration, the host ran out of wine. I'm sorry, John 2, I misspoke. Without wine, the feast was going to go downhill fast. The celebration would be subdued and the joy diminished. For a wedding feast at the time, not to have wine, it's like not having fans at the Super Bowl or at our Super Bowl parties. There's no buffalo chicken dip, which I can't imagine. It's like not having presents at Christmas. That's the sort of thing they were confronting. It sucks the air out of everything. Without joy, a wedding is just not a wedding. Now, at this particular wedding, Jesus is there with his mother, Mary. And she recognizes the problem, and knowing well that her son could do something about it, she decides to insert herself into the situation. Now, Jesus, though, you know, anytime your mom says, hey, why don't you take care of this? It's someone else's thing. Insert yourself into this. This isn't your problem. I don't know many sons who are like, yeah, mom, I want to do that. That sounds fun. Jesus was not ready to act. He said this in response to her invitation to remedy the lack of joy. He says, dear woman, that's not our problem. My time has not yet come. So in this instance, Mary is not only asking Jesus to intervene, but to reveal who he is to the people in attendance. But what happens, interestingly, is that once he tells his mother that and Mary disengages from the situation, leaving it entirely in Jesus' hands, then he does decide to act. His mother says to the servants, do whatever he tells you. So into this dangerous void of joy at the wedding feast and in the face of a lack of wine, Jesus chooses to do the first sign revealing who he is to those around him. This is verse 6 and 7. Nearby stood 6 stone water jars, the kind used by Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. So they filled them to the brim. Now, this may seem like a meaningless detail that Jesus transforms, because we know what's about to happen, right? Transforms water used for ceremonial washing into wine. But the narrator, John, in this case, does not include this detail without a purpose. This water was used for purification, for preparing the Jews to enter God's presence. It's not just any water, it's holy water. Jesus transforms the holy water, the water of purity, into the wine of joy. The wine was not just for the joy of the moment, but it points to the joy that can be only found in the most joyful being in the universe, God himself. It is preparing people to discover the joy of God. Now, not only did Jesus transform holy water into the wine of joy, he also did so in abundance, right? There were 6 20 to 30 gallon water basins there. Instead of just a little wine, Jesus transformed the water into 120 to 180 gallons of wine. That is a lot of joy. There is plenty of joy. This joy is going to last for like the whole week of the celebration, right? Abundant joy, overflowing joy is not just an aspect of God, but it is a characteristic of the kingdom that Jesus is inviting people, inviting us to live in. In the kingdom, there is enough. There is plenty of joy to go around. And you can live in that kingdom marked by the love of God and the love of others right now. You can experience this joy, the joy of God and the joy of the celebration we have been inviting into. Not just someday, but today. And something like our gathering today and the meal we're going to have is just a small taste of that joy that we participate in together. The story continues. Jesus addresses the servants again. Then he told them, now draw out some of the wine and take it to the master of the banquet. They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now. Then the story concludes, what Jesus did here was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory and his disciples believed in him. So normally, as the master of ceremonies recognizes, the more people drank at a wedding feast, the less the quality of the wine mattered. But when Jesus got involved, the best wine was saved for last. Jesus didn't turn the water of cleansing into just any wine, but into an abundance of the very best wine. This was a sign of joy, a sign that Jesus was who he said he was, and a sign of the future joy that he would usher in. Now, every week we set up a free water table here on campus. It's a chance to serve U of A, to make God's love tangible to people that we don't know, and to share our faith when questions about why we were there, what we were doing come up. Now, one time at this auspicious event, I was at a table where a few women were discussing the importance of a dinner at a wedding celebration. The importance of joy, right? How significant that moment is. And, you know, two of them were convinced that a dinner was like really important. But there was a third woman there who we'll call Megan, conveniently the name of my wife, who was much less convinced. She was advocating for a sort of soup potluck reception after a wedding. And her friends were horrified. And as her now husband, I was also horrified. Soup? We're gonna bring our own soup? Who even likes soup? Renee and my wife, that's it, right? Soup might be good. I know there are a couple I like, but that's not overflowing joy to me, right? A wedding celebration should be the representative of the joy of two lives being forged into one future. And Jesus, see, this is how you win an argument. Jesus certainly was an advocate for the joy of the wedding feast. And this is a picture of the community he was creating at the time and that we continue to aspire to today together. Jesus tells us later in John 15:11, I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. Jesus longs for us to share his joy. And when we miss out on joy, we miss out on the fullness of life that God has for us. C.S. Lewis said that joy is the serious business of heaven. And it's time that we learn to grow in our joy. Without joy at the wedding feast, it's just a shadow of what it should be. Without joy in the community of Jesus, we fail to reflect the fullness of God to each other and to the world. Philippians 4:4 tells us, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. The Bible doesn't tell us to be joyful when we feel like it. It commands us to be joyful. Joy is not an optional thing for us. Now, thankfully, because this can seem a little intense, the Bible doesn't call us to something that is impossible. We can grow in our joy despite your personality or your circumstances. Joy is something that we can learn and develop, and it was no one else's responsibility but your own. All of us must choose joy. It may be hard, but it can be done. So how can we grow in joy? Let me give you just a few thoughts. First, we can begin today. No matter what is happening, no matter how good or bad the day has been, we need to choose joy today. Many of us think that we will experience joy someday in the future, when school is over, when we have that job, or we've met the one, or we've had a few kids or even grandkids, when the retirement account has reached a certain point, once our suffering is over. And we spend our lives waiting for a day that may never come. We can't wait for perfection, but rather we must choose to rejoice and give thanks in this day, because this is the day that the Lord has made, and this is the day that we are living. The future is not guaranteed. Now, to give you a caveat, choosing joy is not choosing to turn a blind eye to suffering or difficulty in life, or ignoring the very real and painful things that happen. And God does not ask us to do that, but instead, I believe that choosing joy is a way of choosing the narrative that we frame our lives and our experiences through. Let me give you an example. Right when the pandemic was starting in March of 2020, my wife and I, our family, and some of our team from our church spent a week in Cuba doing a service trip, and we met a man named Oscar in Cuba. Here he is smiling his huge smile with our campus minister, Devin. Cuba, as you should know, is a communist country, and for the people there, the government is your life. They control everything, and that either means that your future is bright or your future is dismal based on your relationship with the communist government. Now, Oscar worked in the cabinet of Fidel Castro and was a very important government official. When his first son was born with medical complications, the cabinet minister of Fidel Castro's cabinet took Oscar's son to the hospital himself, and he told the staff, "You will save this boy." Failure was not an option. Now, Oscar and his family lived on the same street in Havana as all of the other important officials, in a big house, respected and powerful. But then Oscar met Jesus, and he became a Christian. And in Cuba, that is a dangerous decision, especially when you work for Fidel Castro. When Oscar committed his life to Christ, he wasn't just intellectually assenting to life with Jesus. It potentially meant losing his life. Oscar would talk about how he would see people go into Fidel Castro's office and then never come out again. And when Oscar became a Christian, it was a very real possibility that he would be called into that office and would face the same fate. Now, when people began to get suspicious about Oscar's newfound faith, he was lucky because his wife's family had ties to the government. So they didn't want to just get rid of him because they wanted to care for these other people. So Oscar wasn't executed, he was only fired. The trouble is, in a communist country, the jobs that exist are jobs with the government. There aren't other jobs. So Oscar didn't lose his life, but because he was a Christian, he lost his job. And because he was a Christian, he lost his house on that street. Because he was a Christian, his family refused to speak to him. And he and his wife and his baby son, who lived, they moved into a shack on the river. And when the river flooded, Oscar would wake up in the morning and sink his feet ankle deep into water and hold his shoes over his head and walk to find work to feed his family that day. And he would say, "God is good to me." I have never met a man with more joy than Oscar. And it is not because his life was easy and wonderful or free from sorrow and trouble. Externally, his life was incredibly difficult and hard. But joy is not dependent on our circumstance. Joy is not dependent on the sorrows or hardships or the lack of them. Oscar's deep and penetrating joy was an intentional perspective on his life that came from intentionally recognizing the good and beauty of God in the midst of darkness and was something that the Holy Spirit produced in him. Joy is not made by everything going right. Joy is not our external circumstances. Joy is the internal perspective and posture we take to our external circumstances. Joy is the orientation to God in the midst of the valley and the shadow, the touchstone of reality of God's goodness and care despite what is going on around us, that the future is secure. Joy does not require a lack of suffering. In fact, true joy is most often developed and cultivated and strengthened in suffering. This is where the Bible gets really unpopular. James 1:2, "Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy." Now, I don't know about you, but this is not my natural response to troubles and difficulty. I don't often think when my children are screaming or work is crazy stressful or I'm being mistreated by others, I don't think, this is a great opportunity for me to strengthen my joy muscles. I sometimes wish this verse said something along the lines of, when troubles come your way, fix it or get angry or be cynical or internalize how hard and unfair life is and dwell on that. Right? Isn't that a little bit more like what we actually do when this happens? But that's not what God says. That's not what the Bible is saying is the path to flourishing and the path to life. God says, consider it an opportunity for not just joy, but for great joy. And here's the key to joy. Consider is a thinking word. It's talking about a mindset, a mind frame, an internal perspective that we are choosing. God is not saying that suffering and troubles are joy, because that would be very confusing and doesn't seem to match reality, right? But rather, he's saying that it is an opportunity for joy. Because while you may not be able to control your external circumstances and the legitimately bad and hard things that happen to you and to those you love, you can control to choose to write your internal narrative through the perspective of joy. You can stop and consider and think. You can make it an opportunity. You can shift your focus and narrative from the negative to the hidden gifts that God has woven into your life. You can choose joy like Oscar chose, waking up in a shack in ankle-deep water, cut off from his family, not sure how he's going to get food for his family that day. He's lost his position in his former life, and he can say, and you can say, God is good to me. I am convinced that if Oscar can do that, you can too with the Lord's help. And what's beautiful is that joy is one of the fruits of the Spirit. This is not merely a practice or choosing joy today or intentionally reframing our narratives, but it is something that the Spirit of God produces in us as we rest in God's love and let the Spirit reign more and more in our lives. So this is not merely making choices. This is also allowing God to do what God does. In Galatians, Paul tells us, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So you want to increase your joy, increase your time with God. As we spend time with God, as we center our lives and our hearts on the way of Jesus, the Spirit will produce in us this fruit. We can pray for joy. We can cultivate our relationship with God. And as we choose joy and frame our stories through the joy of Christ, we will begin to know peace in spite of circumstance and joy even in suffering. And that is Christ in us. That is Christ in our community that enables us to do that. But God invites us to choose, to partner with him in that work. It's not like waving a magic wand. It's actively choosing joy and choosing to dwell in the presence of God that will produce this in us. So let's be people who choose Jesus and enjoy and choose to rejoice in what we have today. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us give thanks and rejoice in it. All that we have is today. And if we are going to be joyful ever, this is the moment. Today is today and the day for us to do that. Now, I'll try and redeem my relationship with my wife as we close here. When I was growing up, one of the greatest parts of church life for me, maybe not for everyone, but for me, were the potlucks. I mean, these weren't soup potlucks. Occasionally, a soup would show up. But potlucks. Now, I'll be honest. I don't really know why it's called potluck, and I had no interest in looking it up. So I'm just going to speculate because that's more fun. I will assume that potluck got its name from the numerous pots of delicious food that were bought by all who attended. Now, as a small child, I may not have been able to see inside those pots, but I knew whichever pot I dipped into would be a lucky one. Why? Because you don't bring your worst food to a potluck. You bring your best food. The joy of the best foods and the creativity that the people had to offer was everywhere. People cheated on their diets. Vegetarians sampled meat for the first time in months, and carnivores learned that even vegetables can be delicious when prepared correctly. And no one left the potluck hungry. There was always plenty of food. There was an abundance of food and an abundance of joy. Regardless of what is happening in life, regardless of the challenges we have been facing, and sometimes because of the challenges, as the Bible tells us, it is vital that we gather together to celebrate all that is good in life. The potluck was a great feast of joy where all were welcome, and there'll be more on welcoming next week with my wife. But this is what the community that follows Jesus looks like, that loves God and loves others, is a community of celebration and joy because we have more to celebrate because of Jesus' life and death and resurrection than anyone else in the world. So let me encourage you this morning. Jesus' invitation into his kingdom, into his way, was always an invitation into community. It was never an invitation into an individual spiritual life. Not following by himself. It's not ride or die with Jesus. It's ride or die with the people of Jesus who are formed by Jesus and are led by Jesus and centered on Jesus. Following Jesus is not a solo mission. It's teamwork and community and togetherness focused on the way and the love of Christ. And it's an open invitation to the community of great joy formed around the table of Christ. Now, you don't get to this great dinner party if you don't accept the invitation of Jesus, not just to come, but also to participate together. If you are longing for community and friends who share your love for Jesus, remember that commitment precedes community. You have to say no to the other invitations to accept the invitation of Jesus or to accept the invitation into our community here. I can't keep my options open and have a great marriage. I can't hold out hopes for something better than playing with my kids if I want to be a good father. I can't skip all of the opportunities to celebrate my nephew or sister-in-law and be a good uncle or brother-in-law. I can't have great friends if I don't choose to prioritize those friendships. I won't find a great church community where I'm known and loved and can grow and participate in the good and beautiful work and life of Jesus if I don't commit to one. There is no community without commitment. So let me encourage you to commit, because when you commit, you will discover the community that you've been looking for. So start today. If you're here, start today. Do the uncomfortable thing to stay after church and have lunch with us. We bought all the food. It's not exactly a potluck. You know, we do that too. That's coming. We have a dinner party planned for the end of the series where you can come and have homemade food. In this instance, we want to worship. There's food. There's drink. Do the uncomfortable thing of staying. We're going to feed you. We're going to bribe you to stay and meet someone that you don't know and say hello and make just a small movement towards community. Then come back to another worship gathering or one of the other events that Megan was talking about that we're having this month or this week, and make an effort to form genuine connections. They will only happen if you commit to coming and to practicing the presence of God and the people that he loves so dearly that are formed in the way of Jesus by the Spirit of Jesus. How incredible would it be if our communities, the communities of Christ all over the world, were known for incredible joy. If we were people not with artificial, fakey smiles, happiness, but a deep, abiding joy in spite of our circumstances. How incredible would it be if people thought of the church as the community of the great feast, as the community of the best dinner parties? We can be that community. We can be people who grow in joy together, who celebrate in spite of our pain, who recognize all that is good and sweet in life, who welcome all to the table of God and are changed together in the presence of Jesus. The Father has invited us in. Will we accept the invitation to share his joy and his presence? And will we invite more and more people to join us? It's time to become the community of the feast. That's what we're going to explore together the next few weeks. Let's commit to that as we pray. Heavenly Father, we love you. We admit that it's really, really easy to focus on the negative, to dwell on hard things, to get angry, to get bitter, to tell ourselves stories about our life in which we always seem to lose, in which everyone seems to be against us, Lord, where things never go our way. Lord, help us to learn to tell a new story. Help us to recognize your goodness in even the small things, to celebrate and be grateful for the good and beautiful gifts that you've given us that we often overlook, and begin to view our lives, both in the past and in the future, through your lenses of irrepressible joy. When we rest in our security with you, Lord, in our identity that you have loved us before you formed us in our mother's wombs. You know the hairs in our heads, and you know our hearts, and you long for us to flourish in life and love after your son, Jesus. May we do that together. It's in Jesus' holy and precious and joyful name I pray. Amen. We're going to pause just for a moment to reflect, which is something that we do every week at Damascus Road. It's a moment to say, like, okay, I just listened to this. Is there something that I'm going to take away from this? What am I going to do in light of the challenge to choose joy in my life? So if on your little meetings, there's QR codes there. I think there may even be a QR code on the screen as well. You can scan that QR code. It will take you to a chance to respond through our Church Center app, which is where you can find everything about Damascus Road, all the events that we do. It's all there. If you feel like, I don't really know what's going on, you probably haven't been at Church Center recently. So scan that, fill out the response card, give us the information you're comfortable with us having, and then make a commitment. Say, I will choose joy today. Say, I will commit to community. Or you can select your own thing. You can also indicate that you have a prayer request and sign up to receive other information if you'd like. But this is just a moment to pause and reflect and say, what am I going to do in light of the message about joy and being a community of joy this morning? So a song will play, reflect for a moment.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Come and lift your hands and raise your He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still. Turning tragedy to triumph. Turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle. So take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice when you cry.
Moment for personal reflection. Now it's time for corporate reflection. So we're going to do an activity together. And I want to be clear, if this is your first time at our church, we're committed to a number of things. We're committed to practicing the presence of God and practicing the presence of people and having that be a consistent thing that we do. And we're also committed to participation. We don't think church is something you just watch, but rather something that you engage in. So what we're going to do is a gratitude activity, where we choose to see our lives through the eyes of joy. So before we take communion together, it's set up here really nicely. Megan Stibrich will come facilitate that in a minute. We're going to just take a few minutes to remember and rejoice in all of the good that God has done in our lives and in Jesus' life and death and resurrection. We're just going to take about 10 minutes to give thanks. So think through perhaps categories of blessing in your life. You can write on your meeting if you want. Think about, like, what are some personal things I'm thankful for? What are some spiritual things? Family. What are the good and beautiful gifts that God has given me? My body is functioning relatively well. Whatever it is, take a few moments to just reflect privately. And in the back, if you look back, Tyler standing right behind Aaron and Renee back there, we have some big sheets of paper where I would love you to stand up. This is about participation, right? Not just personal. Stand up and go and write something there. And write something that you're thankful for, that you're grateful for. And maybe read some of the things that your community is rejoicing over as well. So take just a couple minutes, think of a few things, and then go back and write something on the paper, and let's celebrate together before we celebrate the Lord's Supper. Thank you.
morning, everyone. If I haven't met you yet, I am Megan Stibrich. I'm one of the staff members here. That's my little boy crying in the back. So I'm one of the staff members here at Damascus Road, so I'm so delighted that you're here this morning. Ryan brought up potlucks earlier, and one thing that you should know about me is that, is that I love to cook. So if there's a potluck, I am bringing food. I will always bring food. You can count on me to bring food. I will do that. And another important thing is that if someone has a food allergy or a dietary restriction, if you need something that's vegan or gluten-free or whatever, I will figure out how to make that for you. Not because I have those dietary restrictions myself, but because it matters to me that everyone has something delicious to eat. You shouldn't get stuck with like the crappy salad just because you have a dietary restriction. Everyone deserves to have something at the table. And that's part of the joy of coming together as a community for a meal. And when we receive communion together each week, we're remembering another table, one that Jesus invites us into as his beloved friends. The Last Supper itself was also a dinner party. We might not really think of it that way, but it's something that Jesus put a great deal of thought and preparation into. In his final hours of life, he took this time over a meal with friends. He poured it into his relationships. He served them all over this final dinner together. Jesus graciously provides this bread and this wine, his body and blood given as a sacrifice to ransom us back to God. Jesus has welcomed us to this table as friends, ones that he loves so dearly that he gave his very life for us. And when the time came, Jesus and the apostles sat down together. Jesus said, "I have been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering begins. For I tell you now, I won't eat this meal again until its meaning is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." He took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took a cup of wine and said, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you." There's bread and wine set up here at this table. And in a few moments, we'll come up. You'll tear off a piece of bread, dip it in the wine, and eat. And after that, after we've had the chance to take communion together, we'll worship God through song as a community, offering up praises for God's extravagant goodness towards us. But for now, let me pray, and then let us enjoy the gift of communion together this morning. God, I thank you for your presence here with us. I thank you for the opportunity to gather as a community every week. I thank you that you don't have us go through this life alone, Lord, that you bring us to the table together. And more than anything, God, that you bring us to the table through your Son, that we are all ransomed back to you through your Son's sacrifice, through Jesus' victory over sin and death, and that we come together to remember that every week, no matter what our individual weeks looked like, no matter what differences we may have, no matter what people we know or don't know, or how awkward we may feel coming into this morning, God, that we are here to come together. We come together at your table that you invite us into. And we thank you so much for that, Lord. We love you in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. So for communion this morning, a song will play. So I invite you to come up here. So I'll have you guys, you come up through the front and then exit through the side just to help things run smoothly. There's some hand sanitizer up here. And if you are someone who needs gluten-free bread and wine, there is extra right here. It's labeled, and another cup for you to dip into so it doesn't get contaminated. So I should invite you to come receive communion as a community this morning. Thank you.
I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I won't hunger anymore at his table. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. And I won't hunger anymore at his table. Come all you weary, come and find. His yoke is easy, table.